Welcome to PayPod, the show that features thought-provoking interviews with leaders and entrepreneurs in the payments and financial technology industries. From credit card processing to Bitcoin, we cover it all. So if you want to know what's happening right now in the payments industry, stay tuned. Now, here's your host, Scott Hawksworth.
Hey everyone out there in the world of payments and fintech, Scott back with you, serving up another episode of PayPod, the payments industry podcast. And this week we are diving headlong into a topic which I know many folks in businesses and payments, especially in online spaces, will find fascinating. And that topic is digital transaction authentication. But before introducing our guest, let me ask you a quick question. Have you ever really thought about what's going on behind the scenes when you've decided on a product or service you want to buy online? You've entered your credit card information into the checkout page and clicked that submit button. Take a moment to ask yourself, what helps keep online credit card transactions secure? What kind of behind-the-scenes challenges does financial technology need to solve when it comes to e-commerce? Think even further. How has the growth of e-commerce impacted payments? Joining me on the show is Kevin Crockett, who is a fantastic person to discuss all of this with, as he is the Senior Director of Global Client Services at Cardinal Commerce. For those who don't know, Cardinal Commerce is a global leader in authenticating digital transactions and operates as a wholly owned subsidiary of Visa. Kevin, welcome to the show.
Hi, Scott. Thanks for having me.
And to start us off, Kevin, can you tell us just a little bit about your journey into the payments industry and your role at Cardinal Commerce?
Sure. So I actually joined Cardinal about 6 years ago, and I was brand new to the payment space entirely. So I was actually working at a global manufacturing company, working on their CRM technology as a business analyst. And the opportunity came about at Cardinal, who just happened to be based in the hometown I grew up in, to come over here and essentially build out their customer relationship management technology. So from there, I learned our businesses, our technology, our processes, and really, most importantly, our customers. And since then, I've continued to take various roles and opportunities at Cardinal as my overall knowledge of the payment space has continued to grow. And as of right now, I work in our global customer services group, heading up post-sales activities for our merchant-facing groups.
Absolutely. And as someone who is newer to the payments industry myself, I can tell you there's a lot to learn. And I feel like I learn something new every day. And I'm sure you would agree.
That is very true. Understatement.
So for those who may be unfamiliar, at a high level, what does Cardinal do? How does it fit into the payments industry and connect with card issuers, merchants, and consumers?
So I think, as you already mentioned very nicely, Cardinal is a global leader in authentication technology. We're a wholly owned subsidiary of Visa. And really, our sole focus is consumer authentication for the digital commerce space. So our solutions are built on the 3D secure authentication protocols, which are really a distinct set of processes that occur prior to authorization. So authentication for online digital transactions allows a merchant and a cardholder to exchange data real-time during a transaction prior to authorization so that consumer can be authenticated by their financial institution.
Boom. That's such a succinct way of putting it. And this is all things that have been developed as the internet has exploded and all these e-commerce is taking place. If possible, can you give us just a little bit of a history lesson? You know, we know what it's like today, but what was the landscape like in e-commerce before Cardinal and other companies came in and really started focusing on providing safe and secure e-commerce transaction? I'm curious, what were some of the early challenges in an era with emerging consumer demand for the ability to use credit cards online, but a landscape where these things like fraud was even easier to commit?
Sure. The original version of the 3D Secure Protocol was developed in the early 2000s. So if you imagine what buying in the online space was like back then, it was heavily browser-based. There weren't a lot of JavaScript type solutions and things of that nature. It was pretty much a vanilla web experience. There wasn't any sort of concept of mobile commerce yet at that time. So in the early stages of 3D Secure, The user experience was predominantly one of a consumer or cardholder having to enroll themselves in the program with their card issuer if their card issuer was participating. And if the merchant was also participating and 3D Secure was invoked on a given transaction, a consumer would be prompted to enter in a static PIN or passcode that they had previously established. So in the early days, it was a higher degree of friction during the checkout process. If consumers weren't enrolled, then issuers could opt to take their cardholder through a multi-step enrollment process during checkout, which wasn't something that a whole lot of merchants wanted to support, just due to some of the abandonment issues that caused, because there was such a high degree of friction being introduced at the point of sale. So as the landscape has really continued to evolve, we've seen a huge migration over the past, you know, 6-7 years from static password authentication on the 1.0 protocol to what we call risk-based authentication. So this allows the issuer to implement a risk-based solution on their side, on their ACS, which is what the issuers use to authenticate their cardholders. And that allows them to passively or seamlessly authenticate more transactions behind the scenes based on this exchange of data without needing to step up and introduce two-factor authentication into every online buying experience.
Wow, and that's just so huge.
Yes.
So we all remember, well, most of us should, when EMV started to roll out in the US. And as a reminder for those who are listening, EMV stands for Europay, MasterCard, Visa, and it's another term for chip cards. I remember well when I would walk into a store and they started ordering me to stick my card in rather than swipe it. And I was fascinated to read that while this made in-person transactions more secure, but it allows more fraud to happen with card-not-present transactions. Can you explain why that is? I thought the whole benefit of chip cards is that it's more secure all around.
Yeah, sure. So when you look at a remote CNP transaction, the chip in that card is not used at all. During an in-person transaction at a point-of-sale terminal, the chip creates a special one-time code used with that transaction that cannot be reused. So if that card number were stolen, say, during a breach or something of that nature, or counterfeit cards created, the stolen number and transaction code could not be used, and any fraudulent attempts at a point-of-sale would essentially then be declined. So now that the point of sale transactions have been further locked down via the EMV chip and PIN, fraudsters are looking for different ways to essentially infiltrate those cards. And a natural progression would be to go to the growing digital commerce space. So 3D Secure can really help catch those fraudulent attempts. So when merchants and issuers use 3DS digital transactions, Cardinal is a service provider to, you know, both types of those clients alike. It allows them to secure that digital space by increasing that amount of data that's exchanged prior to authorization.
So I want to dive into that because, you know, we've mentioned it, 3D Secure, that is the solution to this. And without getting too technical, how does it work at a high level? And why is it so effective in authenticating cardholder identity and helping transactions process both securely and efficiently in spite of EMV being more vulnerable in the card not present situations?
That's a great question. So in a 3D Secure transaction, I'm shopping online, I'm on my device, I'm going through the checkout process, and I click place order. What 3D Secure does then is it allows a facilitator like Cardinal to package up a bunch of information about the cardholder, you know, what they're entering into their cart, their device and browser that they're using, their card number, the amount of the transaction, email, phone number, IP address, things of that nature. And we package it up into a request and then send it off into the card issuer. So the card issuer then has what they call an ACS on their side, which is built off of a risk model that leverages all of these various data points that we send in during the transaction flow. So that risk model generates a score that the issuer can then use to either choose to authenticate their cardholder and say, yes, definitely Scott, we know his device, we've seen him at this site before, we'll go ahead and authenticate him without really needing to ask him for any additional information. Or something looks weird about this. This is a newer email address that was opened. This device reputation score is outside the norm of what we would expect. So we're going to choose to send an OTP or a one-time password to the mobile device that Scott has on file, just so that we're adding in that additional layer of validation, at which point then you would be displayed a screen to say, hey, we just sent a OTP to this particular device. Please enter it here. And then that's how you would essentially tie out to the authentication process on your side. You'd enter in the OTP, and then that transaction is secure from an authentication perspective.
Wow. So if I have this right, it's essentially taking all this information at once, you know, in the transaction and then presenting it to the issuer to say, hey, now I can see all of this. And if there's anything that looks a little strange or, you know, is outside of what our normal risk would deem it, then you can go to that next level. Do I have it right?
Yep, that's correct. And we discussed a little bit earlier about 3D Secure 1.0 and the current state of the protocol. That's really based off of a limited set of data because it was developed back when, you know, mobile commerce wasn't even really a thing. So we're actually in a transitional state right now into the EMV 2.0 version. It's called EMV 3DS. We refer to it as 2.0 as well. But that version of the 3DS protocol has now been updated. So all of the players in the authentication space are updating to these new specifications. And really, the whole basis behind this is let's increase the amount of data that's exchanged during the initial authentication so that the issuer has more information to make a more informed decision as to the given risk of a transaction without needing to challenge their cardholders as much. So 95% of the transactions can be seamlessly authenticated behind the scenes much more quickly, much more efficiently, without the consumer even really needing to know what's going on, unless they do need to get challenged because some sort of risk threshold was hit on the issuer side.
That makes so much sense. If we have the technology to even give more information to help make better decisions, that's a logical progression to me.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, false declines. These are one of those things, and I know we've got folks listening right now, that's a nightmare for the merchant and the consumer. Can you share a bit about the scope of the problem? You know, why is it such an issue, and approximately how big is the impact of these false declines?
Sure. So false declines are one of the key things that the EMV version of the 3DS protocol is really looking to address. So when we're looking at scoping out the problem itself, false declines are really growing at a double-digit rate in the U.S. according to VisaNet 2017 data.
Wow.
So there is a previous study that was done by Javelin in 2015 that revealed in the U.S. alone, the value of false declines was 13 times as much as the value of fraudulent transactions. So 39% of cardholders abandoned that payment card after a false decline, and an additional 25% reduced overall utilization of that card. So when you're falsely declined, you either abandon the transaction altogether, or you'll take a different card out of your wallet and store it into that merchant profile if you're able to get the transaction to go through successfully. So,
right.
You know, false declines are very top of mind from both, obviously, a merchant and an issuer perspective. Top of wallet is very important to card issuers, and obviously consumer experience and sales are important to merchants. So we're looking to EMV 3DS as being a mechanism to give issuers more confidence in approving authenticated transactions.
Right, more information, so that would logically reduce the amount that they make a decision that is ultimately not the right one because it's a false decline, correct?
Correct, yes.
And just from the consumer side, I can feel for consumers and merchants because I've had that frustration where it hasn't gone through and then I've reached for a different card because I'm like, well, this one obviously isn't working. So, you know, and in some cases, we live in a world where so many people want to get their products now. They want to get this now, now, now. If they have that, they may abandon altogether. So definitely it behooves everybody to reduce those.
Right.
Are there additional things e-commerce merchants, for example, can do to help reduce the chance of false declines outside, obviously, the great technology that Cardinal's developing and things like that?
Many merchants use various fraud tools to make sure that CNP transactions aren't fraudulent, but that tool's job is to stop anything that looks like fraud. And that's really how a lot of, you know, false declines happen.
Right.
When you're using authentication and you're getting these results from the issuer that's essentially validating the identity of the cardholder, you can use the output of the 3D secure process and feed that into the other fraud tools that you're using, because it's really not a one size fits all solution. Either it's 3D secure or it's another fraud tool. Really, merchants should be using these things to complement each other so that you're further strengthening your fraud strategy to say, okay, I know this was an EMV 3DS transaction. I feel really confident that it's a successful validation of this person's identity. So I can choose to decline or review fewer transactions on the merchant side to help allow more sales to go through. So it helps allow merchants to make more informed decisions on their end as well and layer that into other tools that they're using.
I think that's so important to point out that when you are talking about things like fraud and false declines and all of this, there's no one silver bullet that it's like, we'll just do this one thing and then it's always going to work out. In a lot of payments and just business in general, having a plethora of solutions and more information to allow you to make better decisions, I think that's just key.
Right. We've talked a lot about, in some of our previous conversations, this silo effect where you have merchants operating in a silo and they have their strategy and they're declining transactions on their side due to risk. The issuers are declining transactions on their side due to risk. You know, the Cardinal authentication network, which helps bring merchants and issuers together, this exchange of enhanced data can really help break that silo effect and hopefully reduce the amount of false declines while continuing to help secure the actual transactions themselves. So it's really a win-win from a merchant and issuer standpoint.
Absolutely. And you know, you were kind of mentioning, we were touching on this a little bit earlier, but can you share just a bit about the consumer authentication that Cardinal Commerce provides if a transaction requires it? What is it? When is it used? And why? Some merchants, we've just been talking about, you know, fears of cart abandonment and things like that. They might be wary of adding extra steps for fear of that. So how might you put some of those fears to rest if there's a merchant listening to this right now?
So I think a lot of those fears really stem from a legacy perception of 3DS and this static password, high friction user experience that's going to lead to higher abandonment rates. As we've migrated towards risk-based authentication, and as we go into the EMV 3DS version of the protocol, it's really designed to seamlessly authenticate consumers behind the scenes without them really needing to even do anything or even know about it. So when you look at a 3D Secure 1.0 transaction, there's a browser redirection involved, there's something that's presented to the consumer. In a 3DS 2.0 transaction, merchants can integrate the Cardinal using various methods. So we have JavaScript-based solutions, API-based solutions, SDKs for native mobile applications. We can really custom tailor the implementation itself based on the needs of the merchant. And we can invoke these processes behind the scenes while the consumer is actually still checking out. So by the time place order is clicked, essentially 90% of the authentication process could have already completed. And then from there, it's a very quick and seamless experience. From the consumer standpoint, very easy implementation from the merchant standpoint. And we anticipate that 95% of the transactions in the US will be able to be authenticated without the need for any sort of consumer presentment or strong two-factor authentication. Only the riskiest 5% or so transactions could be subject to that type of experience. And in that case, if the issuer is choosing to step up and say, hey, I want to send an OTP to this device, or I'm going to send a push notification to their mobile app on their device and have them authenticate themselves, it's due to some reason. It's not just, hey, we're going to do a static password on every transaction. It's no, we've really assessed the risk on this transaction. We don't think this is Scott making this purchase. So we just want to make sure. So it's really a mechanism to help combat actual fraudulent transactions.
Absolutely. And I want to underline that because I think that's such a good point that it seems like the technology is going forward and getting to the point where if something like that happens, it's only because there is just a really good reason and all of the other factors have come in and said, hey, here's a flag here. We need to look at this. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
So I've talked to a number of folks in different areas of payments about fraud and combating fraud and all these kinds of things and essentially staying ahead of the bad guys, so to speak. And I'm curious, what are some of the ongoing challenges when it comes to combating fraud and protecting sensitive card information in 2018, 2019? How is Cardinal working to meet these challenges?
So as we've been discussing, one of the best ways to fight that fraud is by using a tool like 3D Secure to help exchange this information with the card issuer. Cardinal has a variety of solutions in place to help our merchants implement this solution. We can help them understand how they can incorporate it into some of the other fraud strategies that they may be employing on their side. And, you know, from our perspective, you know, from a product and platform standpoint, Cardinal has various solutions in place, JavaScript, API, like I had mentioned before, to really meet the needs of the merchants and the issuers alike. And we're also a fully compliant from a PCI DSS security standpoint as well. So all of our solutions are secure, our data centers are secure, and we have a variety of options that merchants can choose from.
So it's all about continuing to work on the technology, meet the standards, the tough standards that have already been set out, and then just keep moving forward. I think that makes so much sense.
Correct. Yep.
So, okay, can you peer into the crystal ball? I'm curious, where do you see Cardinal Commerce in, say, 3 to 5 years? Are there any long-term projects you guys are working on or overall goals that you can share, maybe things coming down the pipeline that you think businesses might really benefit from?
So I think, you know, from that standpoint, that's an interesting question, because when I look into the crystal ball, the future's really here right now. I mean, we've been talking about EMV, 3DS, 3DS 2.0 for the past 3 to 5 years. We know that there's pending regulatory items going into effect in Europe this year around securing digital transactions in those countries. We've been talking about that for the past 3 years. So really, we're at a point now to where these things are actually here. We're actively piloting 3DS 2.0 transactions with various merchants and issuers. We're working through the regulatory landscape and things that are coming into fruition in 2019. So really, you know, from my standpoint, all of the things that I've been talking about the past few years are here now. So I think that's really kind of where we sit. What does this next, you know, year or so look like as we're getting more and more critical mass adoption of some of these updated technologies and solutions that we have been working on the past 3 to 5 years?
Right. So it's the technology has been developed. It's here now. It's just now, how do we keep pushing it forward and spreading it everywhere, right?
Exactly.
So we have a segment that we like to end with where we do a fast five questions, rapid fire. Kevin, are you ready?
I am ready.
Make a prediction about the future of payments that you expect will happen in the next 12 to 24 months.
Specifically speaking to online payments, the future will really be based on how providers like Cardinal, merchants, issuers can come together to understand how we can secure more digital transactions while continuing to provide the best possible user experience.
Absolutely. What's one cool piece of payment-related technology you've come across recently that's unrelated to your company that particularly impressed you?
Actually, I was reading in Digital Transactions, the November issue, I believe, about touch-and-go contactless cards that are being utilized more and more across Europe as they have more critical mass adoption of near-field communication at the point-of-sale terminals. So basically, this is a card that instead of dipping into a terminal, it's touch-and-go, it's much quicker, not something we've seen a lot here in the U.S. a lot. So as more and more NFC terminals are being supported by retailers and merchants in the U.S., I'm interested to see how that adoption looks over here over the next 12 months or so.
I'm interested to see that as well. That's awesome. In the next 5 years, most Americans will make a purchase with either Bitcoin, Apple Pay, some other thing. Which one and why?
So if I just go ahead and speak from personal experience here, I would go ahead and say Apple Pay, just because I've been using that more and more. As more and more merchants are accepting it, there are situations where if I'm choosing between grocery stores or gas stations, I'll go to the one that I know supports it. I'm always trying to ditch the wallet whenever I can. And I don't know if you're familiar with Seinfeld or the episode where George Costanza was carrying around that like big clunky wallet in his back pocket. That's kind of how I feel about it. So I'd like to just travel with my phone and travel light whenever possible.
That's proof right there. We had an episode a few weeks back where we talked all about Apple Pay, and that's the adoption right there. So I'm with you on that.
Nice.
What's one piece of advice you would have for someone who's considering the payments industry as a career?
I would say get as involved as much as you can, learn as much as possible, and more so, you know, be willing to take risks. You know, when I joined Cardinal, I was working at a global manufacturing firm, Fortune 500. I essentially made a leap of faith to join this small technology company that was based in Mentor, Ohio, that's, you know, now owned by Visa. So that ended up being one of the best choices I ever made. I was willing to make that risk,
right,
and take that leap. And it, to say the least, it's worked out.
Last one. What's the best business advice you've ever received and from whom?
So I remember my father previously telling me that sometimes it's best not to have your presence known, but have your absence felt. So walking into a room, not always needing to make your presence known, but more so just be that subject matter expert, be that go-to person that people always want to ask questions to and seek counsel and advice from. And that's really how you prove your value to your organization, your company, and your overall cause.
I love that. That's good advice. I'm writing that down. Kevin, I wanted to thank you so, so much for joining me on the show today. This was really, really informative.
Thanks for having me. Had a great time.
Absolutely. And if folks are curious and they want to learn more about Cardinal, where should they go to learn more about the great things you guys are doing?
Oh, definitely. You can always visit our website, www.cardinalcommerce.com. I'm also wanting to share my contact information as well. So feel free to get in touch with us through those channels. And we're always ready, willing, and able to talk about authentication. It's what we do, and we love doing it.
Love it. Thanks again, Kevin.
Thank you, Scott. Appreciate it.
Well, that's it for our show today. Thank you so much for listening. And if you like what we do here, don't forget to rate and review us on iTunes or whatever your preferred podcast listening platform is. We'll be back with another episode very soon.
Thank you for listening to another episode of PayPod, brought to you by Soar Payments. Soar Payments is a leading merchant services provider for e-commerce, high risk, and hard to place businesses. If you'd like to get the latest PayPod episode sent to you automatically, subscribe to the show via iTunes or Stitcher, or visit soarpay.com/podcast.